timeframe is problem posing education as a humanist and liberating practice. Posits as fundamental that the people subjected to domination must fight for their emancipation. To that end, it enables teachers and students to become subjects of the educational process by overcoming authoritarianism and an alienating intellectualism. It also enables people to overcome their false perceptions of reality. The world, no longer something to be described with deceptive words, become the object of that transforming action by men and women, which results in their humanization. Which is what we see today with the banning of the books. You know, we are now problem posing this and taking action and becoming subjects and not objects where you dominate us and tell us what to think and how to think and what to read.
We're going to do a couple readings right now before we go back to the music. Up next, I have Andrea Serrano. Up next to read. Round of applause for Andrea Serrano.
From Dream Cultura, Chicanismo by José Antonio Burciaga, and it was a book I read when I was in high school, and it made a real big difference in my way of thinking, as did a lot of the books that are on the banned list. And of all the things that, all of the desmadres that have come out of Arizona in the last 2 years, I think the banned book list is the one that hurt me the most. So I'm just going to read a very short passage from He Who Serves Two Masters Disappoints One or Both. This question may bother you, began the radio interviewer in Mexico City. But do you write as a Mexicano or... The question trailed off, but he didn't have to finish that one question forever asked of Chicanos by Mexicanos. What exactly are you? The question was not only expected, but welcomed. So the answer was quick and enthusiastic. Yo soy Mexicano, I answered, but added in Spanish. And I am a Gabacho. Culturally, I have as much of the Mexicano as I do of the gringo. I am as comfortable with the Mexican as I am with the Anglo-American culture. Never before had I claimed to be a gabacho or even thought of myself as one, much less proclaimed it in a live radio interview. Yet at that instant, I found it necessary to emphasize and reaffirm my cultural and patriotic allegiance to the United States of America. Not to U.S. policy in Latino America, but to the United States of the people. I am the Southwest. I am tortillas and frijoles, but I am also hamburgers and hot dogs. We are both. We are the vanquished, the victor, wrote Corky Gonzalez in his epic poem, I Am Joaquin. Poet Jose Montoya said it another way. The theys are us. And Pogo's famous line, we have met the enemy and it is us, was all too applicable to the Mexican-American. Another friend said, I am Mexican by nature and American by nurture. We were caught on the razor-sharp edge of two vastly different cultures, and in trying to identify with each side, while condemned by both sides, we denounced both and identified a third alternative with a little and a lot from each side. We became Chicanos.
Up we have Nessa and Elisa Pintor reading from Zoot Suit.
Too bad, essay. He set you up again.
Solitary, essay. They gave me solitary.
Better get used to it, carnal. That's what the storch is gonna be about, ese. You're in here for life, vato.
I can't accept it, ese.
You got to, huh? Only this reality is real now. Only this place is real. Sitting in the lonely cell of your will.
I can't see my hands.
Then tell your eyes to forget the light, ese. Only the hard floor is there, carnal. Only the cold, hard edge of this reality. And there is no time. Each second is a raw drop of blood from your brain that you must swallow drop by drop and didn't even start counting or you'll lose your mind.
I've got to know why I'm here. I've got to have a reason for being here.
You're here, man, because you chose to be here, because you protected your brother and your family, and nobody knows the worth of that effort better than you, ese.
I miss them, ese. My fitos, my carnalillo, my sis, I miss Stella.
Forget them. Forget them all. Forget your family and the barrio, beyond the wall.
There's still a chance. There's still a chance I'll get out.
Fat chance.
I'm talking about the appeal.
And I'm talking about what's real. ¿Qué traes, Hank? Haven't you learned yet?
Learned what?
Not to expect justice when it isn't there. No court in the land's going to set you free. Learn to protect your loves by binding them in hate, ese. Stop hanging on the false hopes. The moment those hopes become crashing down, you'll find yourself on the ground, foaming at the mouth, como loco.
¿Sabes qué? Don't tell me anymore. I don't need you to tell me what to do. Papa, papa!
Órale, pues. Don't take that pinche play so seriously, Jesús. Es puro vacilón, guacha. This is Los, carnal. You wanna see some judges and pachucos? Check out what's happening back home today. The Navy has landed, ese, on leave with full play, and war is breaking out on the streets of L.A.
I'm getting interesting in here. Next up we have the wonderful Dr. Lahati in the press.
People's history of the United States of America, 1492 into the present. This was one of my readings when I was in college. I went to a black college. This is a bedtime story, everybody. It's about Columbus, the Indians, and human progress. Arawak men and women, naked, tawny, and full of wonder, emerged from their villages into the island's beaches and swam out to get a closer look at the strange big boats. When Columbus and his sailors came ashore, carrying swords, speaking oddly, y'all heard that before, the Arawaks ran to greet them, brought them food, water, and gifts. He later wrote of this in his log. This was his experience for Columbus from back. They brought us parrots and balls of cotton and spears and many other things, which they had exchanged for the glass beads and hawk's bells. They willingly traded everything they owned. They were well built, with good bodies, and handsome features. They do not bear arms. They do not know them. For I showed them a sword. They took it by the edge and cut themselves out of ignorance. They have no iron. Their spears are made of cane. They would make fine servants. With 50 men, we can subjugate them all, make them do whatever we want. These Arawaks of the Bahama Islands were much like Indians on the mainland, who were remarkable. European observers were to say again and again for their hospitality, their belief in sharing. These traits did not stand out in the Europe of the Renaissance, dominated as it was by the religion of popes, the governments of kings, the frenzies for money that marked Western civilization and its first messenger to the Americas. Christopher Columbus wrote again, "As soon as I arrived in the Indies, on the first island which I found, I took some of the natives by force in order that they might learn and might give me information of whatever and wherever there was gold." You can wake up now.
So we have three more readings, and then we'll go back to music. But I'm going to name the folks who are up next. We have Jessica Mischetti, Karen Cathy, and then Leonor Lara. So I'll welcome Jessica up to the stage.
Buenas noches, ¿cómo están? Mi nombre es Jessica. Estoy un poquito nerviosa porque es la primera vez que voy a leer con tan buena presencia a este público, ¿no? Yo... Bueno, el libro que voy a leer es de Tomás Rivera y se titula "Y no se lo tragó la tierra". El capítulo es un rezo. Dios, Jesucristo, santo de mi corazón, este es el tercer domingo que te vengo a suplicar, a rogar, a que me des razón de mi hijo. No he sabido de él. Protégelo, Dios mío, que una bala no vaya a atravesar el corazón, como el de doña Virginia, que Dios la tenga en paz. Cuídamelo, Jesucristo. Sálvalo de las balas. Compadécete de él, que es muy bueno. Desde niño, cuando le daba de mamar, era muy bueno, muy agradecido, nunca me mordía. Es muy inocente, protégelo a él, que no hace el mal a nadie, es muy noble, es muy bueno, que no le traspase la bala el corazón. Por favor, Virgen María, tú también cobíjalo, cúbrele su cuerpo, tápale la cabeza, tápale los ojos a las comunistas, a los coreanos, a los chinos, para que no lo vean, para que no lo vean. Para que no lo maten, todavía lo guardo sus juguetes de cuando era niño, sus carritos, sus troquitas, hasta una águila que me encontré el otro día en el cuartito de su ropa. También las tarjetas y los fomis, ahora que he aprendido a leer. Le tengo todo guardado para cuando regrese. Protégelo, Jesucristo, que no lo maten. Ya lo tengo prometido a la Virgen de San Juan, una visita a la Virgen de Guadalupe también. Él me trae una medallita de la Virgen de San Juan del Valle y él también le prometió. Quiere vivir, cuídalo, tápalo su corazón con tu mano para que no le atraviese ni una bala. Es muy noble. Tenía mucho miedo al ir, él me lo dijo. El día que se lo llevaron, al despedirse me abrazó y lloró un rato. Yo sentía su corazón palpitar y me acordaba de cuando él era niño y le daba de mamar y de cómo le... gustaba a mí y a él. Cuídamelo, por favor, te lo ruego, te lo prometo, mi vida, por él. Tráemelo bueno y sano de Corea. Tápale el corazón con tus manos, Jesucristo, Dios Santo, Virgen de Guadalupe. Regrésamelo. Y regrésame su corazón. ¿Por qué lo has llevado? Él no ha hecho nada, él no sabe nada, es muy humilde. No quiere quitarle la vida a nadie, regrésenmelo. Vivo, que no lo quiero muerto. Aquí está mi corazón por el de él. Aquí lo tienen, aquí está mi pecho palpitando. Arrancándomelo, si quieren, sangre. Pero arrancámelo de mí, se los doy por el de mi hijo. Aquí está mi corazón, su misma sangre. Regrésenmelo vivo y les doy mi corazón. Gracias.
¡Gracias!
author of this book, and he was born in New Mexico village of Astura, but grew up in Santa Rosa. The theme of his writing include a strong sense of his Chicano heritage, an emphasis on the wisdom of the old ways, and a continual quest for spiritual healing that includes indigenous, Catholic, and Eastern traditions. The landscape of New Mexico provides the setting for most of his work. Indeed, La Tierra becomes a dominant theme, a holy ground, the field where all human drama is measured. And the illustrator is Gaspar Enriquez. Here's a quote from Gaspar. As an American artist with a Hispanic background, my art is about the personal relationships and events that dominate my two cultural environments. My most recent work with airbrush painting and the depiction of Cholos deals directly with my daily experience with the people I know, individuals who remind me of friends and people I grew up with. Using that same style, I created the paintings for this book. So it's Eulogy on the Death of Cesar Chavez. So I'm just gonna read the side part, because you can read the side and read it all the way through, or you can read the whole, the inside part. I'm just gonna read this side. The earth he loved so well is dry and mourning. This man who was a guide across fields of toil. How can this man who moved like the light of justice die? Cesar had awakened to a greater dream. A scourge on the oppressors of the poor. Children uneducated in a land grown fat with greed. Like the righteous thunder of summer storms. Rise together and build a new society. I hear the sound of marching feet. He lives in the hearts of those who love him. Rise not against each other, but for each other. Listen to his voice in the wind.
Looking at my mother or my sister's bookshelves at home, so I guess when I was hearing those stories as a child, it was really exciting and new just hearing these stories of people's histories and my history. And as I read them again when I was able to read myself, just the writing was beautiful and her history is beautiful. And it's nice to review these books again, because this time it's empowering, and it's just, you can find so many levels in these books. So I'm just going to read a tiny chunk from the same book this lovely woman read beforehand, Tomás Rivera y No se lo trago la tierra. I'm just going to read a little chunk in English. Sometimes just very simple, simple writing kind of carries a lot of weight. So. It was an hour before the afternoon movie started. He needed a haircut, so he went into the barber shop across the street from the theater. At first, he didn't quite understand, so he sat down and waited. But then the barber told him again that he couldn't cut his hair. He thought the barber didn't have time, so he remained seated, waiting for the other barber. When he was finished with the client, he got up and walked to the barber's chair. But this barber told him the same thing, that he couldn't cut his hair. Furthermore, he told him that it would be better if he left. He crossed the street and stood there waiting for the theater to open, but then the barber came out and told him to leave. Then it became clear to him, and he went home to get his father.
And that's it. Thank you, Leonor. I just want to say we're going to come do music now, and while the músicos set up, I'll have a few words. But I just wanted to let the músicos know that it'll be up after me. Gracias a todos y a todas. I'm truly happy to see everyone here. You know, I'm just listening to these different pieces from these books. You know, it's really making me think, you know, like what's at stake by banning these books in our neighbor state, Arizona. It's just taking me there. It's reminding me of the first time I picked up, you know, one of the banned books as a teenager, and how that totally transformed my life and opened up my eyes and could finally hear myself and see myself in writing. You know, it was a very powerful moment. And so I just wanted to thank Leonor and everyone else who's come up here to read a piece. We're going to do a couple more songs, and then we'll come back to the reading. Thank you.